Hello, intelligent investors, this is Victor here. Several Patreon members asked me to analyze Visa stock to see if it's undervalued now. Recently, Visa stock has dropped as much as 11% because Visa gave lower than expected revenue guidance. The US Justice Department is probing Visa for another potential anti-competitive behavior. The antitrust regulator is looking to see whether Visa's financial incentives to fintech companies such as Square, Stripe and PayPal have prevented them from using other payment networks. If you look at Visa's recent peak, you can see Visa stock has dropped as much as 17%. In this video, I will analyze Visa stock and talk about these topics to see if Visa stock is undervalued now. You will learn about how to value Visa stock and calculate Visa's fair intrinsic value. First, what is Visa's business model? How does Visa earn its revenues? Second, Visa's two biggest long-term growth catalysts. Third, Visa's two major risks you must know. Fourth, Visa stock valuation, how to value Visa stock and calculate Visa stock's fair intrinsic value. And fifth, will I buy Visa stock? If you like this video, make sure to hit the like button, subscribe, and turn on the notification button. I will continue to make many excellent stock analysis and investing videos every week that will help you become a great investor. Also, if you like this channel and want to support it, check out my Patreon blog in the video description and become a premium member. Our goal is to create the best intelligent investor community that will help all our members grow their stock portfolios to over 7 figures over time. With your support, we'll be able to stay independent, hire other outstanding analysts to cover different stocks, and create many excellent stock analysis and investing videos every week that will help you become a great investor. The link is in the video description. Take a look. Let's start. So what is Visa's business model? If you already use Visa debit or credit cards every day, you'll know that Visa is the largest and most popular payment card in the world. MasterCard, which is Visa's biggest competitor, is the second largest and most popular payment card in the world. In 2020, Visa had a market share of 52%, while MasterCard had a market share of 22% in the US. If you combine both Visa and MasterCard, they had a total market share of 74% in the US in 2020. Amex and Discover had much smaller market shares in the US. In the global market, UnionPay is the largest payment network, but it's primarily in China. Now, here's the interesting part you want to know. This is from Visa's most recent annual report. Visa is not a financial institution. We do not issue cards, extend credit, or set rates and fees for account holders of Visa products. That's the role of our financial institution clients. Visa works with more than 15,000 financial institutions around the world to make Visa-branded payment products such as Visa debit card, Visa credit card, and Visa prepaid cards for consumers, businesses, and government account holders. Visa does not have credit risk like banks because Visa does not give you credit. For example, if you don't pay your Visa credit card, the bank that issues the credit card carries the credit risk, not Visa. So what is Visa's business if Visa is not a financial institution? Visa is actually a payment processing network, also known as VisaNet. Visa's primary service is to facilitate electronic payment transactions between consumers, merchants, consumers issuing banks, and merchants acquiring banks, and to provide value-added payment-related services to all its customers. Visa earns service revenues, data processing revenues, and international transaction revenues primarily from payments volume and the number of transactions that are processed through Visa's payment network. Here's how it works. I will give you an example here. In a typical transaction, let's say you're using your Visa card to buy $100 of groceries at Walmart. Walmart is the merchant here. Walmart does not receive the entire $100. Walmart would only receive $97.8 here. The issuer bank that issued the Visa credit card would keep $1.7 of interchange fees, also known as swipe fees. The acquirer merchant bank that works with Walmart would keep 50 cents of acquiring fees, also known as processing fees. All these payment processing fees combined are what we call the merchant discount fee or the merchant discount rate. The interchange fee paid to the issuer bank is the largest fee in the entire merchant discount rate. According to Investopedia, most merchants can expect to pay a 1% to 3% fee for payment processing of each transaction. Visa earns revenues by charging network assessment fees to the merchant acquiring bank here. Visa's network assessment fee is typically around 0.1% at the time of making this video. Visa's network assessment fee can change from time to time. In this example, Visa should earn around 10 cents of assessment fees from the merchant acquiring bank for facilitating the entire transaction. these assessment fees become large revenues for Visa because Visa processes billions of payments volume every day. This means the more payments volume and transactions that go through Visa's payment network, the more revenue Visa will earn. As I talked about earlier, the payment network industry is a duopoly between Visa and MasterCard in the US and around the world, excluding China. Most consumers use Visa and MasterCard. This means most merchants and financial institutions are forced to use Visa or MasterCard's payment networks. This is what we call the network effect. I believe this is Visa's biggest competitive advantage. In terms of financials, Visa is a very profitable business. For example, Visa has an operating margin of 65.56% for the fiscal year 2021. It has 20.2 billion of cash and investment securities at the time of making this video. In my opinion, this is a healthy amount of cash and investments compared with its current liabilities and its total liabilities on its balance sheet. If you look at this here from Morningstar, you can see Visa has consistent operating cash flow and free cash flow growth, except in 2020 because Visa's payments volume and revenues were impacted by the pandemic in 2020. People were spending less using their Visa cards during the pandemic. But now, according to the latest Q4 earnings, you can see Visa's net revenues, net income, payments volume, cross-border volume and processed transactions have recovered and are growing at double-digit rates again. This is a good sign because it shows Visa is already recovering from the pandemic. We can also expect Visa's revenues from cross-border transactions will recover going forward because many countries are starting to ease their COVID restrictions and travel restrictions. Let's talk about Visa's biggest long-term growth catalyst. I believe Visa's biggest long-term growth catalyst is that consumers are spending more money using their debit cards, their credit cards, their smartphones, and now crypto-linked cards instead of using cash. During the pandemic, consumers started using their smartphones, digital wallets, and their debit and Visa cards to pay for things in stores much more than before. Going forward, I believe using debit and credit cards and contactless payments will continue to be the trend. Also, based on my observation, I see most younger consumers, such as millennials and Generation C, prefer to buy things using their smartphones and their debit and credit cards much more than cash. I mentioned this earlier, Visa and MasterCard are the two largest payment networks in the world outside of China. Most merchants are forced to accept Visa and MasterCard payments because they're the two most popular card brands in the world. If merchants don't accept Visa and MasterCard cards, they would lose a lot of sales. This is why most merchants still accept Visa and MasterCard payments, even if they have to pay high interchange fees, also known as swipe fees. Visa's management said this in the recent earnings call that shows Visa's long-term growth going forward. All that said, we are setting out to invest around the globe, and we want our business to grow in all markets and territories in which we do work. We are more than happy to have the US continue to grow, but I think as I look at the future of the business over the next 5 to 10 years, I expect still healthy growth in the United States, but I do expect our volumes to continue to grow in a nice way around the world. You saw this prior quarter, as good as the growth was in the US in the quarter, both Latin America and CEMEA, Central Europe, Middle East, and Africa had very strong quarters, and international growth was really held back by Asia Pacific, which has really been hit very hard by lockdowns and restrictions as a result of the pandemic. Contactless payments are already 70% penetrated outside the US, so that's still a growth engine in the US that is just beginning to take off. And given the size of the US, that will be a meaningful contributor to transactions growth. And we also know that tap-to-pay digitalizes cash and allows us to capture a much larger share of transactions at point of sale. Blockchains also will continue to expand our network of networks. Our settlement capabilities and our continued innovation around crypto APIs and services have been key to winning new partnerships. We have nearly 60 crypto platform partners with the capability to issue Visa credentials, and we're already capturing over 3.5 billion of payments volume in fiscal 2021. Another trend I see is that many consumers are interested in Visa and MasterCard that let you receive crypto rewards or that let you spend using your cryptocurrencies. As of now, crypto Visa cards payments volume only make up a very small percentage of Visa's total payments volume. For example, based on my understanding of the recent earnings call here, Visa has nearly 60 crypto platform partners and has captured over 3.5 billion of payments volume from crypto-linked cards in fiscal 2021. In comparison, Visa's total payments volume is 12.99 trillion in fiscal 2021. Going forward, I believe crypto Visa cards will become a large growth driver that should drive Visa's payments volume growth because cryptocurrencies, especially Bitcoin and Ethereum, are becoming very popular among retail investors and everyday consumers. This is from CNBC. Visa estimated crypto-linked cards and other emerging payments, including biometrics and QR code, have the potential to disrupt the $18 trillion spent every year with cash and checks globally. Bitcoin's market cap topped $1 trillion for the first time in February and hit an all-time high near $65,000 per unit in April due to retail investor enthusiasm during the coronavirus pandemic as a store of value and inflation hedge. I believe Visa's second long-term growth catalyst is the current recovery of cross-border traveling around the world. Visa earns a large percentage of revenues from international transactions. Visa's international transaction revenues were impacted by the pandemic lockdown and cross-border travel restrictions around the world. Now, many countries are easing their cross-border traveling again. This is why Visa's international transaction revenues have started recovering and growing again in the recent Q4 quarter here. Management said this about Visa's expected growth in fiscal 2022. These assumptions result in high end of mid-teens net revenue growth for fiscal year 2022, including over 0.5 points of exchange rate drag from the strengthening dollar. First quarter growth in the high teens will moderate through the year as we lap the recovery in fiscal year 2021. Many analysts expected Visa's revenue guidance to be higher in fiscal 2022, but management is expecting Visa's revenue will grow close to the high end of mid-teens, which are below most analysts' expectations. The main reason is that management expects cross-border travel will not recover to the 2019 levels until the summer of 2023. This is why Visa stock recently dropped a lot after management gave lower revenue guidance for fiscal 2022. Personally, I believe it will just be a matter of time before all the countries around the world lift their COVID restrictions and allow cross-border traveling again. When traveling is back to the 2019 level, Visa will earn much higher international transaction revenues. Let's talk about Visa's two major risks you should know about. I believe Visa's biggest risk now is the current antitrust probe. According to this article here, antitrust investigators are looking into the financial incentives that Visa gave Square, Stripe, and PayPal Holdings. The company said earlier in March, the Justice Department was looking at its debit practices after reports that the United States was investigating whether Visa uses anti-competitive practices in the debit card market. The Justice Department had previously investigated the credit card payments industry but settled with Visa and MasterCard in 2010 when they agreed to allow merchants to offer consumers incentives to use a low-cost credit card. Obviously, no one will know the antitrust probe's outcome until many months later. If the US antitrust regulator finds Visa is practicing anti-competitive behaviors again, Visa will likely receive a large fine. I believe Visa's second main risk is increasing competition with fintech companies such as Square, Stripe, and PayPal. This is from Barron's. Payment processors like Visa charge network fees to merchants in exchange for access to their vast network. Some emerging fintech companies such as Square, Stripe, and PayPal allow money to be sent without using Visa and other major card networks. Visa has offered lower fees or other rewards to the fintech firms, likely in exchange for them sending more transactions over its rails. Fintech companies such as Square, Stripe, and PayPal let users send money and buy things online and offline in retail stores without using Visa and MasterCard's payment networks. For example, PayPal uses the automated clearinghouse ACH to help businesses send and receive electronic payments without using Visa's payment network. This means fintech companies have the potential to disrupt Visa and MasterCard's duopoly in the payment network market. I believe this is why Visa is likely giving large incentives to fintech companies to convince them to send more transactions to Visa's network instead of using other networks. This all goes back to the antitrust probe I mentioned earlier. Let's talk about Visa stock valuation. Before investing in any stocks, I always use this intrinsic value calculator to estimate the stock's fair intrinsic value, so I will know whether the stock is overvalued, fairly valued, or undervalued. If the company is a great business with increasing earnings and increasing economic moat, the best time to invest in the stock is when it's undervalued. So let's estimate Visa's fair intrinsic value using this intrinsic value calculator here. If you want this intrinsic value calculator, you can download it in my Patreon blog in the video description. Here are the key assumptions. First, I define Visa's intrinsic value as its future cash flows discounted to the present day. The discount rate is 8.5%. This is slightly higher than the 7.5% 7.5% cost of equity, calculated by finbox.com. Of course, you can use a higher discount rate here if you want to be more conservative. The most recent 12 months of free cash flow is 14.52 billion. Based on the catalyst I talked about earlier, I believe Visa's free cash flow will grow at a compound annual growth rate, CAGR, between 10% and 20% over the next 5 years. To calculate the terminal value at the end of year 5, we're using both the perpetual growth model and the exit multiple model here. Then we take the average of both models to calculate the terminal value. Let's go over these three case scenarios: the worst case, the normal case, and the best case scenarios. Under the worst case scenario, we're using a compound annual growth rate of 10%. If we forecast Visa's free cash flow to the next 5 years and discount the free cash flow to the present day, Visa's intrinsic value should be around 387 billion for the entire company, or $177 per share. I'm giving this scenario a 25% probability here. Under the normal case scenario, we're using a compound annual growth rate CAGR of 15%. If we forecast Visa's free cash flow to the next 5 years and discount the free cash flow to the present day, Visa's intrinsic value should be around 476 billion for the entire company, or $218 per share. I'm giving this scenario a 50% probability here. Under the best case scenario, we're using a compound annual growth rate CAGR of 20%. If we forecast Visa's free cash flow to the next 5 years and discount the free cash flow to the present day, Visa's intrinsic value should be around 580 billion for the entire company, or $266 per share. I'm giving this scenario a 25% probability here. If we add all these numbers here, Visa's fair intrinsic value should be around $219.74 per share at the time of making this video. Now, just to compare, Morningstar estimated Visa's fair value to be around $217 per share. This means Visa stock, in my opinion, is slightly undervalued at the time of making this video. So will I buy Visa stock? Yes, I'm planning to buy more Visa shares whenever it becomes more undervalued. I like Visa's market dominant position in the payment network industry. As of now, only MasterCard can really compete with Visa's payment network. I already have Visa stock in my portfolio. It's already a multi-bagger stock. I've been investing in Visa for many years. Based on my estimate, I believe Visa's fair intrinsic value should be around $219.74 per share at the time of making this video. I believe Visa's intrinsic value will continue to grow for many years because of Visa's increasing earnings and because of the increasing adoption of debit and credit cards, contactless payments, mobile payments, digital wallets, and now crypto-linked cards to replace cash. Now, all these estimates are only my opinions and my analysis based on my research. They are not financial advice. Make sure you always do your research and do your extra due diligence first before investing in anything. Do not invest in anything you do not understand. If you like this video, make sure to hit the like button, subscribe, and turn on the notification button. I will continue to make many excellent stock analysis and investing videos every week that will help you become a great investor. Also, if you like this channel and want to support it, check out my Patreon blog in the video description and become a premium member. Our goal is to create the best intelligent investor community that will help all our members grow their stock portfolios to over 7 figures over time. With your support, we'll be able to stay independent, hire other outstanding analysts to cover different stocks, and create many excellent stock analysis and investing videos every week that will help you become a great investor. The link is in the video description. Thank you for watching this video and supporting our channel. This is Victor from the Intelligent Investor channel, and I will see you in the next video.